So student, in today's theory lecture, okay, in this we are going to discuss the two plant hormones, or it is also called as a phytohormones. We are going to discuss the auxin. See, what are the hormones? Remember, these hormones, they are synthesized inside the plant, and these are the organic substances. No doubt, and these organic substances, they take part in the growth of the plant body. Okay, remember, the site of synthesis and the site of action, it is different with respect to this the phytohormones. The phytohormones, they are of five different types. They are synthesized in the plant body, no doubt. So what are those phytohormones? That phytohormones, we have to categorize that phytohormones under the two main categories, that is the growth regulators or the growth promoters, and the next one it is the growth inhibitors. Under the first group, the three phytohormones, they are included, that is the auxin, gibberellin and cytokinin. Okay, and under the next group, that group it is called as the growth inhibitors. Under that, the two phytohormones, they are included. What are those? The ethylene and abscisic acid. Okay, ethylene and abscisic acid. So three growth promoters are there, and the two growth inhibitors are there. Okay, so remember here, the student, the growth regulators, these are the organic compounds, and that organic compound, they are synthesized in the plant body, and they take part in the growth of that plant. Such a type of the organic compound, these are called as the phytohormones. Okay, these are called as the phytohormones. But remember, all the phytohormones, no doubt, the five different types of the phytohormones means the auxin, gibberellin, cytokinin, then the ethylene and abscisic acid. These five different types, they are synthesized inside the plant body. But artificially, we are also prepared the phytohormones. That artificially prepared phytohormones, these are called as the growth regulators. Growth regulators. Okay. So remember here, all the phytohormones, okay, all the phytohormones, they act as the growth regulators. Okay, they act as the growth regulators. But remember, all the growth regulators, they are not a phytohormones. Okay, they are not a phytohormones. म्हणजे आपण इथे सगळ्या फायटोहॉर्मोन्सला आपण ग्रोथ रेग्युलेटर असं म्हणतो, परंतु सगळे ग्रोथ रेग्युलेटर हे याला आपण फायटोहॉर्मोन असं म्हणत नाही. कारण ग्रोथ रेग्युलेटर जे आहेत ते आपण आर्टिफिशियली ही सिंथेसाइज केलेले आहे, की जे फंक्शन हे नॅचरली प्रिपेअर्ड फायटोहॉर्मोन सारखेच दाखवतात. तर हे स्टुडंट इथं लक्षात घ्या. आणि फायटोहॉर्मोन एका ठिकाणी सिंथेसाइज केलं जातं, पण तिथेच न वापरता त्याची साईट ऑफ ऍक्शन ही डिफरंट असते. तर हे तुम्ही तिथं लक्षात घ्या. आणि द मुवमेंट ऑफ दिस फायटोहॉर्मोन, हाऊ इट इज टेक्स प्लेस, इट इज टेक्स प्लेस थ्रू द फ्लोएम टिश्यू. ओके, इट इज टेक्स प्लेस थ्रू द फ्लोएम टिश्यू. सो यू रिमेंबर हिअर द फर्स्ट फायटोहॉर्मोन, दॅट इज the auxin. So it is the first one, the auxin. So this auxin, this is the phytohormone. No doubt, the auxin word, or the name is given to phytohormone auxin. Why the name is given? The name is given on the basis of the Greek word. Okay, on the basis of the Greek word auxin. Okay, on the basis of this the Greek word auxein. Okay, auxein. Auxein means to grow. Okay, means to grow. On the basis of this Greek word, the
name is given to phytohormone. It is the auxin. So you remember. Then this auxin, such a type of the term, it is firstly used by the scientist F. W. Wendt. Okay, who used this word? F. W. Wendt. Okay, F. W. Wendt. They use the word auxin. In 1931, the scientist Kogel, okay, in the 1931, the scientist Kogel, they isolate auxin from the urine of the human being. Okay, urine of the human being. That human, they are suffering from the pellagra disease. So the human which are suffered from the pellagra disease, from the urine of that human, the scientist H. Smith and Kogel, okay, H. Smith and Kogel, they isolate this auxin. Remember, in the plant, the auxin, they are synthesized toward the shoot apex, and that auxin, they shows the polar movement. Okay, auxin, they are synthesized toward the shoot apex, okay, and they show the movement from morphological apex to morphological base. So such a type of the movement, it is called as the polar movement. Okay, it is called as a polar movement. So you remember, this auxin, where they are synthesized, they are synthesized at the shoot apex, means they are synthesized at the shoot apex. They are synthesized, okay, but this auxin, they are also synthesized at the root apex. Okay, they are synthesized at the root apex, and they also show the polar movement, in the sense, in the root, they show the upward movement, means from morphological apex to morphological base. So such a type of the movement, it is seen, or it is shown by this this auxin. So that movement, it is called as a polar movement. Naturally synthesized auxin, it is called as the indol acetic acid, IAA. Okay, indol acetic acid. It is IAA. It is a natural synthesized auxin. And for the synthesis of auxin, the amino acid tryptophan. Okay, for the synthesis of auxin, what is required? The amino acid, the tryptophan, okay, tryptophan is required, and along with that, the zinc element, it is utilized for the biosynthesis of auxin. And what are the artificially synthesized auxin? It is the indol butyric acid, okay, indol butyric acid in AA, and the next one, it is 2,4-D dichlorophenoxyacetic acid. So these are the artificially synthesized auxin. So student, no doubt, we are isolated the auxins from the plant body. No doubt that auxin, they are exist in a free form. Such a type of auxin, we are easily isolated from the plants. And we are also made the auxin artificially, and that artificial prepared auxin, we can easily utilize for the various purposes. So now we are going to discuss the various physiological effects of the auxin. So these are the physiological effects of auxin. Let's say one by one. This auxin, the first physiological effect they show, they take part in cell elongation, okay, or the cell enlargement, and also they shows the apical dominance. So in the presence of, when we apply the auxin, the cell size, they get elongated, or the size of the cell, it get enlarged, okay, the cell enlargement. And what is that? The apical dominance. The apical dominance means, in the presence of auxin, the growth of the shoot apex, it is continuously takes place, and it suppresses the growth of the lateral branches. it is called as the apical dominance. So student, always remember what is meant by the apical dominance. Then the next physiological effect, it induces the cell multiplication. So because of its the property, the cell multiplication means suppose yeah, so because of this they are used in tissue culture. Okay, they are used in tissue culture. Means in the nutrient medium when we have to grow the cell inside the nutrient medium, and when we add the oxygen in the nutrient medium, this cell, it shows the rapid cell division. So because of this, this oxygen, they are used in tissue culture because they shows the cell multiplication property. Then the next one, the 2,4-D, it is the artificially synthesized oxygen. This oxygen, they used as a dicot herbicide. Okay, dicot herbicide. म्हणजे द्विदल तण जे आहेत, जे वीड्स आहेत, ते वीड्स आपण याच्या मदतीने या 2,4-D स्प्रे करून ते किल करतो. हे तुम्हाला माहिती असेल, तुम्ही ते तुमच्या घरी शेती असेल तर ते पाहत असाल. त्याच्यानंतर द फोर्थ फिजिओलॉजिकल इफेक्ट, द इंड्यूस द पार्थेनोकार्पी. सो व्हाट इज द पार्थेनोकार्पी? द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ द फ्रूट विदाउट फर्टिलाइजेशन, it is called as the parthenocarpy. And this parthenocarpy, okay, this parthenocarpy, we can induce with the help of this in case of orange, in case of lemon, in case of grape, and in case of banana, we are to induce the parthenocarpy. म्हणजे आपण याच्या मदतीने ऑरेंज, लेमन, बनाना याच्यामध्ये आपण सीडलेस फ्रुट्स हे प्रिपेअर तिथे करतो. त्याच्यानंतर द फिफ्थ फिजिओलॉजिकल इफेक्ट, under the low concentration in the nutrient medium, they induce the root elongation, and under the high concentration they promote the shoot growth in the nutrient medium. So this is the most important physiological effect. It is seen in the tissue culture. Then the next, number 6, in cutting, when we prepare the cutting, okay, and this is the lower slanting cut in the cutting, and these are having the 3 axillary buds, 2 to 3 axillary buds. And remember, here when we apply the oxygen over that, they induce the rooting in cutting. Then the seventh physiological effect, they prevent the abscission layer, and they also prevent the premature leaf fall or premature fruit fall. म्हणजे पानाची गळती किंवा फळांची गळती ही ह्या ऑक्सिजनच्यामुळे तिथं थांबली जाते, आणि त्याच्याबरोबर तिथं अधिक उत्पादन त्या शेतकऱ्याला त्याच्यातून घेता येतं. त्याच्यानंतर नेक्स्ट नंबर 8, इट ब्रेक द सीड डॉर्मन्सी. ओके, इट ब्रेक द सीड डॉर्मन्सी. व्हेन वी ट्रीट द सीड विथ द हेल्प ऑफ दिस ऑक्सिजन, automatically it break the seed dormancy and it induce the immediate seed germination there. And the last physiological effect, it increase the rate of respiration. So such a type of the observations made in the presence of oxygen, they enhance the respiration rate. In the sense, we observed there, in the presence of oxygen, that plant part, they shows the maximum growth. In the sense, that plant part, they utilize the maximum energy, and no doubt what is the source of energy? The source of energy means the respiration process. So we are to say, or it is known to increase the rate of respiration in presence of the oxygen. So these are the various physiological effects with respect to the oxygen. So now the next growth regulator, it is gibberellin. Okay, so the second number, it is the gibberellin. So this gibberellin, where it is synthesized? They are synthesized in the root tip. Okay, their synthesis, it is seen in root tip. Okay, and in the growing seeds.
okay, growing seeds. So their synthesis it is same. Means when the ovule is converted into seed, during that developmental stages, the GA, they are maximally synthesized. This GA, no doubt, they never show the polar movement. They show the non-polar movement. Okay, they show the non-polar, okay, polar movement. Okay, they show the non-polar movement. Always remember. In the 1926, the Japanese scientist Kurosawa, they firstly discovered and isolated the gibberellin from the fungus Gibberella fusicori. Okay, what they observed there? They observed there, they just after the infection of the rice plant because of the fungus Gibberella fusicori, that rice plant they show the maximum growth. Okay, because they show the increase in internodal distance, and because of the, as compared to the normal growth of the plant, this plant, affected plant, they externally look like a tall plant. Okay, so such type of the disease, it is called as Bakani disease, or it is also called as foliage seedling disease. So this scientist Fujikori, they observed that symptoms, and they studied there why such things happen, and they found that there is an infection of the fungus Gibberella fusicori. So from that Gibberella fusicori fungus, they isolate the biochemical responsible for that type of the Bakani disease. It is the gibberellin. So they isolate that gibberellin. But later in the 1938, the scientist Yaguta and Smuki, they isolate that gibberellin in crystalline form from the same fungus, the Gibberella fusicori. So remember, firstly, who isolate the gibberellin from the fungus Gibberella fusicori? Who isolate that? The scientist Kurosawa. And later, the Yaguta and Smuki, they isolate that in a crystalline form from that fungus. Remember, not only that GA, the GA3, okay, it is the most common and biologically active form of the gibberellin, but near about the 150 different types of the gibberellins or gibberellic acids we have identified or we have discovered. And how we can write that the, like this, the GA1, GA2, GA3, like this way, GA150. So such a different types of the gibberellic acids we are discovered, and we are used, we have using that GA in various purposes. As far as the fruit crops are concerned, or as far as the horticultural point of view is concerned, we have to use that. Then remember this, the gibberellin, what is the chemical constituents of the gibberellin? They are having the basic carbon skeleton. It is in the form of a gibberellin ring. Okay, they are having the basic carbon skeleton in the form of a gibberellin ring. Okay, gibberellin ring, such type of the basic carbon skeleton, it is shown by that gibberellin, means in that basic carbon skeleton, they are having the cyclic diterpene with the four isoprene units. So such a type of the basic carbon skeleton they have. This gibberellin, no doubt they are acidic in nature, and because of its acidic property, it is called as the gibberellic acid. Why they are called as gibberellic acid? Because the cyclic diterpene with the four isoprene unit, in that they are having the carboxylic group, so they are acidic in nature. So we call to that gibberellic it is a gibberellic acid. Okay, so this is in brief the introductory part of the gibberellin. Now we immediately move towards the various physiological effects shown by the gibberellin. This is most important because on the physiological effect, the question is always asked on the physiological effects of the gibberellin. Okay, so let's see the various physiological effects of this gibberellin. See the first physiological effect. This gibberellin, they promote the seed germination. Okay, but how they promote the seed germination? In the presence of the application of the gibberellin, there is a synthesis of the amylase enzyme, and in the presence of that amylase enzyme, the stored food material in the seed, it is in the form of a starch, and in the presence of this amylase enzyme, you know that the starch, okay, starch, it is converted into monomer, okay, it is converted into monomer, and this monomer, they are broken down in the presence of the oxygen, we call it is the respiration process. And what is generated? The energy, it is generated in the form of the ATP molecule, and that energy, it is utilized for the normal growth of embryo inside the seed. So we have to say, when we apply the gibberellin to that seed, they immediately promote the seed germination because of this, the internal metabolic changes. Okay, then the next the physiological effect, they promote the seed stem elongation. They promote the stem elongation. Okay, so what is that? The stem elongation means in the presence of the GF, the internodal distance of the stem, it is increases. So because of that, the stem gets elongated. And then third effect, it is most important, they induce the bolting. Bolting in the sense, in case of radish, cabbage, any beet, in the cabbage, kobi madhe tumhala mahit aahe ki kobi la apan largest bud in the angiosperm manto, tar tyachyamadhe internodal distance kami asyamule tithe aplyala tyacha kobi ha jhalela disto, mhanje ha he je young leaves aahet te tithech wind up hotat आणि आपल्याला असा बड फॉर्म झालेला दिसतो. ओके, पण जर आपण याच्यावरती जीए ट्रीट केलं तर इथला जो इंटरनोडल डिस्टन्स आहे हा इंटरनोडल डिस्टन्स हा वाढतो आणि त्याच्यापासून असं मोठं प्लांट आपल्याला कोबीचं तयार झालेलं दिसतं आणि यालाच म्हटलं जातं बोल्टिंग इफेक्ट. ओके, देन द नेक्स्ट वन द पार्थेनोकार्पी. पार्थेनोकार्पी मीन्स द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ फ्रूट विदाउट फर्टिलायझेशन. Means when we treat that the flower with help of this gibberellin, what happens? They provide the stimulation to ovary, and ovary start growing without fertilization. So when the fruits are from such a ovary, that fruits are the seedless. So that we have the seedless tomato, seedless apple, and the seedless grape. So you are aware with that. Then next most important effect we observe when we apply the GA, just after the application of the GA, the genetically dwarf plant it is converted into normal tall plant. Means when that plant is genetically dwarf, then when we treat such a type of the plant with the help of the GA, then automatically the genetic makeup, they never change, but the internodal distance it is increases, and that plant externally behaves as like a normal tall plant, but genetically that plant it is the dwarf plant. म्हणजे dwarf plant ला जर आपण ही GA ची treatment दिली तर त्याच्यामध्ये टॉल प्लांट एवढी ग्रोथ होते बिकॉज ऑफ द जीए. सो यू रिमेंबर. देन द नेक्स्ट अँड मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टंट इफेक्ट इट इज सीन जस्ट आफ्टर ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ द जीए, वर्नलायझेशन इफेक्ट हा तिथे ओव्हरकम आपण याच्या मदतीने करतो, किंवा वर्नलायझेशन ट्रीटमेंटच्या ऐवजी जीएची ट्रीटमेंट दिली तरी देखील आपल्याला तिथे अर्ली फ्लावरिंग इंड्यूस करता येतं. वर्नलायझेशन म्हणजे काय? वर्नलायझेशन म्हणजे प्लांट्स मध्ये अर्ली फ्लावरिंग येण्यासाठी आपण त्या प्लांटच्या सीडला किंवा त्या प्लांटच्या सीडलिंगला आपण लो टेम्परेचर ट्रीटमेंट देतो, त्याला आपण वर्नलायझेशन असं म्हणतो. आणि इथे आपण त्या प्लांट्स मध्ये असे ट्रीटेड सीड जर लावले तर आपल्याला लवकर त्या प्लांट्स वरती फ्लावरिंग आणता येतात. पण समजा लो ट्रीटमेंट देण्याच्या ऐवजी ते जर सीड आपण या जीएनए ट्रीट केले तर तरी देखील वर्नलायझेशन ट्रीटमेंट प्रमाणेच त्या प्लांट्स मध्ये आपल्याला अर्ली फ्लावरिंग आलेलं दिसतं. म्हणून आपण म्हणतो की बिकॉज ऑफ द एप्लिकेशन ऑफ द जीए द वर्नलायझेशन इफेक्ट विल बी ओव्हरकम अँड दॅट प्लांट द इंड्यूस द अर्ली फ्लावरिंग. देन द नेक्स्ट नंबर सेवन्थ इफेक्ट, इट डिले द सेनेसन्स. सेनेसन्स म्हणजे एजिंग ऑफ दॅट प्लांट. ए जी आय एन जी, एजिंग. ओके, एजिंग. एजिंग हे डिले केलं जातं. ओके, अँड दे प्रिव्हेंट द ऍब्सिशन इन केस ऑफ द लीफ फ्लावर अँड फ्रूट. सो दिस इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टंट एज फार एज द हॉर्टिकल्चरल पॉइंट ऑफ व्ह्यू इज कन्सर्न. अँड द लास्ट फिजिओलॉजिकल इफेक्ट, इट इज द मेल फ्लावर. दे इंड्यूस द मेल फ्लावर ऑन द फीमेल प्लांट इन प्रेझन्स ऑफ द मॅक्सिमम अमाऊंट द ऑक्सिन अँड द इथिलीन दॅट प्लांट दे इंड्यूस द फीमेल फ्लावरिंग. ओके, बट वेन वी इन्क्रीज द अमाऊंट ऑफ जीए मेल फ्लावर्स दे आर प्रोड्यूस्ड ऑन द फीमेल प्लांट इन द प्रेझन्स ऑफ जीए. सो स्टुडंट, विथ दिस वी विल स्टॉप.